our channel Dentistry to the Point. In this video, we are going to continue with the disorders of malabsorption. And as I've mentioned that we'll be dealing with various disorders of malabsorptions one by one. So here, starting with the first, that is inflammatory bowel diseases, IBD. Now, as the name itself suggests, it's a chronic inflammatory disease of the gastrointestinal system. Now, one thing which you have to remember here, and you don't have to get confused between the words bowel and colon. So it is nothing. Bowel is a word used commonly for intestines. That is your small intestine plus large intestine. While colon is a word that is used only for large intestine. So be thorough with it. Now, inflammatory bowel diseases is actually a group of non-specific inflammatory diseases, but the two most common diseases including them are Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis. Now, we'll be dealing with these two diseases in detail in a comparative way. Also, this is a thing to note that in 30 to 40% of the cases, the two diseases are not able to be distinguished because of their so common factors or similarities, but still differences exist between them, which you'll see later in the video. Also, these diseases are less common in black and more common in the American Jews, and both sexes are equally affected. Both the diseases can occur at any age with a peak incidence between 15 to 20 years. Okay. Now, what in same way have is their etiology and pathogenesis. So let's see it. Firstly, etiology, so an exact cause or initiating event in both the diseases is still unknown, but few factors have been implicated. First is the familial and genetic disorders, that is hereditary most commonly. So in 10 to 15% of the cases, patients have relatives with inflammatory bowel disease and then it is passed. Also, high rate is seen in monozygotic twins. And there is a close or a strong or increased association with ankylosing spondylitis. Talking about the infective, second etiology is infective disorders. That is when there is colonization of the bacterial or bacterial overgrowths. So these bacteria antigens, they produce inflammatory responses in the mucosa, which produce ulcerations and causes inflammatory bowel diseases. And thirdly is immunological disorders. Now, why immunological disorders? Because if there is an inflammation and there is no isolation of any infective agent, so immunology, that is your autoimmunity, that is body responsible for causing harm to its own healthy cells, that remains a strong possibility in the etiology. And lastly is smoking. Now, this cigarette smoking is actually strongly associated with Crohn's disease and not with ulcerative colitis. Okay, moving on to the pathogenesis. So the pathogenesis is somewhat complicated, but you don't have to go into so much details. You just have to listen to it and see the image popping so you get a better understanding. So the bacterial antigens are taken up by the M cells or they pass between the leaky epithelial cells. Now, what are these M cells? These M cells are nothing but these are known as microfold cells. These are specialized epithelial cells which are present in your intestines and they lack their brush borders. So that your microparticles or bacteria, they pass through the mucosal barrier. So when these enter, so as they enter in the lamina propria, so they are presented to the type 1 T helper cells by the antigen presenting cells in the lamina propria. Okay. And then the T cell activation and differentiation results in Th1 T cells mediated cytokine response. That is, inflammatory response starts. Jab ye particles leak out hoke ya M cells ke through aate hai, so there is your T helper cell mediation. Uski wajah se cytokine response aata hai. And with the secretion of cytokines, including your tumor necrosis factor alpha, further inflammatory processes with activation of other important cytokines like interleukin 1, 6, 12, etc. are also released or secreted. Okay. Now, these pathways occur in all normal individuals who are exposed to inflammatory changes, and this is self-limiting in healthy subjects. Okay. But in genetically predisposed persons, okay, in genetically, that is, they're already having or it is genetically predisposed, dysregulation of the innate immunity may trigger inflammatory bowel diseases. If this is in a healthy person, okay, so there is no such changes seen. But if it's in a genetically predisposed person, so the immunity is altered and then there is trigger or initiation of inflammatory bowel diseases. Now, starting with individually both the diseases, that is your Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis. So we'll do a comparative study so that you get to know the similarities as well as the differences. Okay, so the introduction for both the diseases goes as that these both are chronic inflammatory diseases, but firstly for Crohn's disease, affecting any part of the GIT, that is from the mouth to the anus. Okay, so remember this, that Crohn's disease is a chronic inflammatory disease affecting any part of the GIT from the mouth to the anus, but the most common sites being, so these are in the order wise given, that is your terminal ileum, right side of the colon, colon alone, terminal ileum alone, ileum or jejunum. Okay, this will be clear as I'll pop the diagram and highlight the areas where it affects. Similarly, ulcerative colitis is a chronic inflammatory disease affecting most commonly rectum and the sigmoid colon. Okay, so it commonly affects the rectum and the sigmoid colon, but it can affect any part of the GIT from the mouth to anus, and the common sites being these. Okay, first major difference, the site of location. Okay, next is we move to the clinical manifestations. So you have moderate diarrhea and pain in the abdomen in the right lower quadrant with tenderness. Here there is severe diarrhea with blood, mucus and pus. Pain and tenderness in the abdomen in the left side. Okay. Mass may be palpable on the abdominal and rectal examination. It is an inflammatory mass. No such mass is palpable here. Recurrent abdominal colics are common due to obstruction. No colicky pain, diffuse pain associated with distension of the abdomen. Now, what is this abdominal colics? These are nothing but intermittent abdominal pains which have a sudden onset and they cease. That is, ekdam se pain ho jana, they have sudden onset and then suddenly cease also by their own. So, aise colicky pain hona, beech beech mein chota chota pain hona abdomen side mein. So, this is common in Crohn's disease, but there is no such colicky pain here, but the pain here is associated with distension of the abdomen. This colicky pain is due to the obstruction in the abdomen actually, and this pain is associated with distension of the abdomen. Features of malabsorption of fat, carbohydrate, proteins, vitamin D, vitamin 12 are common. Okay, but here the malabsorptive features are less common, but dehydration is more common. So these are the striking clinical manifestations as you see. Then you move on to the complications. So the complications, you have relapses or remissions, which is common in Crohn's disease and also in ulcerative colitis. Moving on to the strictures of the anal fissures. Now the confusing terms come here as, what are strictures? What are fistulas? What are abscesses or fissures? So strictures are nothing but these are the abnormal narrowing or the constrictions or the restrictions which are present. Okay, so strictures are that which are common in the Crohn's disease, while these are uncommon in the ulcerative colitis. Even the anal fissures, these are nothing but it is a small tear in the mucosa of the anus, like thin mucosa hoti anus ki. So there is a small tear in that mucosa, and this may occur when you have your hard stools or very large stools na, at that time anal fissures can occur. Then you have abscess and fistulas. Now fistulas are nothing but abnormal openings which are present. Okay, now these are actually something tunnel kind of openings, you can see that is abnormal opening, which is, or a passage or a tunnel that is connects to abnormal places. For example, like it is an abnormal opening in the GIT that causes the gastric fluids to seep through the lining of the stomach or intestine. Okay? It can result in infection when these fluids leak into your skin also. So this is nothing but an abnormal connection between the stomach or intestine to any other body parts. It's a tunnel created. I'll pop an image that will make it more clear. So these abscess and fistulas are more common in Crohn's disease, while less common in the ulcerative colitis. And carcinoma in situ is less common in Crohn's, while there are more chances of developing carcinoma in situ in long-standing ulcerative colitis diseases. So from here you can infer that your Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis have some distinguishing points, like diarrhea with blood here is present, severe diarrhea is present, okay, in situ cases are more common, no colicky pain, and the location or their extent, okay, which they affect. and most commonly thing you can interpret from this is nothing but your ulcerative colitis, you can say, is a chronic inflammatory disorder of the rectum or your sigmoid colon that results in ulcerations and bleeding, while your Crohn's disease is a chronic inflammatory disorder of your terminal ileum or the right side of colon or any part, resulting in ulcerations, strictures, fistulas and abscess formation, as these are more common here and less common here. Moving on to the histopathological features, so these are divided into macroscopic and microscopic. So talking about the macroscopic features, so in Crohn's disease you have discontinuous lesions with skip areas present, while in ulcerative colitis you have continuous areas with no skip lesions. Now what are these skip lesions? Actually these are nothing but when a small area of normal mucosa in its way is separated from an involved segment, that is a skip lesion. Okay, that is, the disease is progressing and then a small area of normal mucosa is left and then the disease progress. So that that non-diseased area or a small area of normal mucosa is known as skip lesions. So Crohn's disease shows this kind of lesion, that is your skip areas are present. Okay, while the ulcerative colitis has continuous lesion with no skip areas. Deep ulcers with edematous mucosa in between is present, which gives it a cobblestone appearance, that is ulcers are deep and non-hemorrhagic, while polyps and pseudopolyps are present, that is ulcers are superficial and hemorrhagic. Okay, now polyps or pseudopolyps are nothing but these are abnormal tissue growths or abnormal masses popping out in the lamina propria. So here the ulcers are edematous with mucosa in between, okay, giving it a cobblestone appearance. More clear as I'll pop a picture. Pseudopolyps and polyps are present here, abnormal masses. The ulcers are deep and non-hemorrhagic, while the ulcers are superficial and hemorrhagic. Microscopically, the infection is transmural and here it is mucosal and submucosal. Now, transmural means occurring or existing across the entire wall of the organ. Okay, so it is occurring the entire wall of the organ, but it is only to a mucosa or submucosa level. The lesion is a non-caseating granuloma, but granulomas are absent here. The crypt abscess is infrequent, while here it is frequent. The goblet cell population is normal, but here there is loss of goblet cells. And the width of the mucosa is either normal or increased, while here it is either normal or decreased or reduced. Talking about the extra-intestinal features, we have involvement of the eyes, joint, skin, liver and heart. So in eyes, like your conjunctivitis or uveitis, these are less common in Crohn's disease, while more common in the ulcerative colitis. Talking about the joints, that is your arthritis, arthralgia, ankylosing spondylitis, less common here, while more common in the ulcerative colitis. Talking about the skin, that is your erythema nodosum or gangrenosum. So these are common here, while it is less common in the ulcerative one. Talking about the liver, you have hepatitis or fatty liver, more common in the Crohn's disease, less common in the ulcerative colitis or uncommon there. And in the heart, you have your mitral valve prolapse or your aortic regurgitation, which are less common in Crohn's disease, while more common in the ulcerative colitis. This is all for this video, where we covered with the introduction, the clinical features, histopathological features, complications, extra-intestinal manifestations and everything related to the Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis. In the next part, we'll be dealing with the investigations and the treatment plan or the management of both the diseases. So stay tuned for this. And if you enjoyed this video, then please like, share and subscribe to our channel. Also hit the little bell so that you're notified every time we upload a video. And stay tuned for the next part on this. Thank you so much.